Hello, I'm Kelvin Leibold, ISU Extension Farm Business Management Field Specialist, and I'd like to talk about the economics of tiling today. There's a lot of information available on our Ag Decision Maker website, and the URL is listed below. Want to know if tiling will pay? So a lot of people think about different ways that you can measure how it pays. For some people, it's getting into the field sooner after it rains. Maybe it's getting the maximum amount of yield. Maybe it's managing costs. But there's a lot of different reasons people would want to spend money on tiling. And in recent years, actually, getting tax deductions has been a big part of that. Well, the advantages of tiling is you get a better aerated root zone, more timely field operations. You get a better crop stand. It's more uniform. I think we utilize nitrogen more efficiently. And if we can farm all the field at one time, all that farm at one time, we're not making multiple trips back there to that field or that farm to try to replant it or whatever. And so it should lower our machinery costs as well. And that's going to make more efficient use of labor. Well, you don't need to look at the total costs. You can go back in and just look at a partial budget to try to figure out your decision. So you're going to need to look at what will change from an income standpoint if you tile, trying to get a handle on how much of the area will actually improve the production, how many more bushels that you'll get, and then you get out your crystal ball and try to project what the price will be down the road here as you're paying for that tile over time. And then on the cost side, there's the cost of the tile and what other costs change because you do tile the field. So I just grabbed some numbers off some old research data that looked at projected yield increases per bushel per acre. And so for on the really swampy stuff, maybe we can get 50 more plus bushels of corn per acre and maybe 18 bushels more of beans. If the stuff is moderately well drained but still needs a little bit of help, maybe you're down in that 12 bushel of corn area or 5 bushels of beans. Anyhow, hopefully you can go back to your combine yield monitor maps, take a look at several years of data, overlay that data, and come up with your own assumptions for each of your individual fields. The cost of tiling is always a question that I get. When we look at the costs, it depends on the size of the tile, but the other thing, when I try to get quotes from contractors, they tell me that, well, you know, if I got to deliver $1.5 million worth of equipment out there to the field to start the job, I really need to know how big the job is. So these are just some guidelines. Again, we can see pattern tiling on fields running anywhere from $400 to $1,000 an acre, depending on the cost of the outlets. Well, if I'm going to get the farm well tiled, maybe I'm going to spend a little bit more money on seed, get more bushels, I might need more fertilizer. I've got greater operating costs, so I got more bushels to haul and to dry. And occasionally, I'll have to go back out there and fix those tile for a variety of different reasons. Well, again, going back, trying to figure the cost, there's 43,560 square feet in an acre. So if we take our line spacing, divide that into 43,560, we'll come up with the dollars per acre for the tile cost. Then, depending upon your situation, you've got to put in a main. Those mains can be very expensive if you're in areas that don't have a lot of low-cost outlets. So again, you come up with a total drainage cost per acre. Well, after you've determined that number, this is an example of a worksheet where you can go in and run those numbers. And in our example, we came up with about $500 an acre that we were planning on spending on draining this field. Well, how quick is the payback on that? I said we were going to have some other variable costs, so go back and try to get a handle on the seed, the fertilizer, and those other miscellaneous costs. You can do that. We've got a worksheet that you can use. But we've also got a spreadsheet on Excel that you can download and run the numbers. But anyhow, I just said, hey, I'm going to average 20 bushel yield better on my corn and 5 bushel an acre better on my beans. I grabbed my crystal ball and said the long-range price of corn was 3.5 and soybeans was 8. You can put your own numbers in. But anyhow, when I got all said and done, I thought I'd generate $70 an acre more income off of corn and $40 an acre more off beans. So I went down and looked at the cost side. I'm going to spend a little bit more money on seed, maybe on the corn, a little higher plant population, a little bit more on fertilizer. And I get down there to the machinery costs. If I don't get stuck in the mud hole, maybe I don't have to get the wrecker out there. I can save a little bit of time. I don't have to go back and replant. So I just came up with $16 and about $360 on beans. So if I take a look at my net change, taking my costs or my revenue minus my costs, I come up with about $54 on corn and $36 on beans. If I was half corn, half beans, I expect to get around $45 an acre more income. Okay, so is that $45 going to pay for that $500 and some dollars we spent out there? Well, maybe one way is to go to looking at this worksheet that's table one gives us the break even. If I go over here and look at the $525 on the left there, come across and look at about $45 in revenue, that's going to show me about 6.5-7% return as far as the interest rate, again, with those assumptions at the bottom of the chart there, looking at 15-year straight line. So in today's world, if I can get 6-7% return on my money, I think that was a pretty good investment. Another way to do it is to go back and look at the internal rate of return. So if, again, I'm looking at $525 as my tile cost, come over to my $45 net increase in income, it says it's a 6.61 internal rate of return. Again, even with those relatively low prices on corn and soybeans, it seems that maybe tile is going to pay. Well, again, I mentioned we had a spreadsheet where you could run the numbers. This is the URL address off the Ag Decision Maker website where you can download that spreadsheet. So somebody's got to put the money up front. If you're an owner-operator, you get to put all the money up front and you get all the benefit. If you're a landlord, you're going to need to recover those costs either through additional cash rent, or if you're a crop share, you get about half the benefits back on a typical 50-50 crop share lease. If the tenant pays for the tile on land that they don't own, that means that they need to have some type of a long-term commitment, and the rate of rent has to be a long-term commitment as well. Well, you take a look at the landlord financing this. Maybe they think that 3% would be a good rate of return. So if they're going to put in more money, then they're going to want to get at least 3% return. If they have to borrow that money, maybe they think that 7% maybe is a better return that they need. So again, that's one of the reasons that a lot of the land has never been tiled is because of the cost of borrowing capital to do that. So if you spent $600 in this example on tile, if the land was renting for $200 an acre and you wanted to get 3% back on your $600, well, you need another $18 an acre rent. If they had to go out and borrow the money on that $600, well, at 7%, well, they'd need another $42 an acre rent. So, you know, maybe the tenant thinks that that's a good arrangement and is willing to pay more rent in the long term if they can get some better drainage with the current weather situation. Well, one of the things to think about is tax considerations, and these change every year. Probably the biggest one has been this Section 179, allowing up to $500,000 in write-off for an owner-operator. So it's pretty easy to bury a lot of money so the IRS can't find it. Section 179 allows us to do that. There's other rules as far as bonus depreciation that, again, you should check with your tax preparer to see how they apply to you. I just gave you the chart on here on bonus depreciation. An owner can take bonus depreciation as long as it's new property, but it does get phased out over time. There's other tax changes that are going to occur too, probably. We seem to be writing the tax laws after the year is over. Just some more thoughts here that you need to check with your tax person. All right, so maybe the tenant wants to pay for the tile. Landlord doesn't want the money or doesn't have the money, or doesn't want to spend the money. So we talk about, well, maybe we can fix the term of the lease. Or maybe we can fix the term of the rent, the amount of rent. Anyhow, a lot of these things would be nice, but landlords maybe not willing to agree to do that. So if we have the tenant pay for the tile and the installation, another option is for the landlord to substantially reduce the rent. I've seen that in some cases where landlords bought land, turned around and rented it out, and this is one way to get around some of the depreciation rules. Okay, so you can go to the Ag Decision Maker and get more information. If you just go to the search box up on top and type in tile, you'll see the different publications and the spreadsheet as well. Here's an example of the file on the Ag Decision Maker. It's C2-90. And here's an example of the spreadsheet as well. And so you can fill in the yellow boxes with the data that you're interested in. Okay, one of the things that we did do is develop a lease supplement for those tenants that pay for tiling. They can go in and have this notarized and recorded at the courthouse, so it proves that they're entitled to some reimbursement in future years if the rent doesn't get renewed. So the idea is here is that maybe you spent $500 an acre on tile. You have an agreement with the landlord that says if you don't get to rent the farm for the next 5 years, they've got to reimburse the tenant 20% of the cost of the tile for every year that you don't get to rent it. So again, we can work with you on some of those issues if you contact us. So in conclusion, you take a look at how many acres are going to be benefited, how much more the profit increases, and how is that affected by income taxes, and can a portion of the investment be offset by increases in land value. We all know that when you go out to buy a farm, if it's pattern tiled, it's going to be worth more. So even though the tile might be depreciated out over time, it still adds to the value of that farm. But the really the big issue in conclusion is have you had a wetlands determination done on the land? Is it legal to tile? And so make sure that you go through those steps first before you start tiling to make sure that it's actually legal to do that, and the Natural Resource Conservation Service can run those determinations for you. With that, thanks for being a part of this program. And if we answer any of your questions, be sure to contact us at the ISU Extension.